Good evening and welcome to the October 20th regular monthly school board meeting. In keeping with our goals that the board has set, engaging our community, we are excited that we have the opportunity to come to you, to the community, and invite the community to come, and we want to hear from the community. A lot of times when we have board meetings at City Hall on the sixth floor, sometimes parents just don't have an opportunity to come. So we wanted to make sure that at least twice a year we're out in the community, and so that the community can come to us and that we can hear from you and your comments. So we welcome everyone this evening, and we're glad that you're here. At this time, I'd like for you to stand for a moment of silence. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, I will ask Dr. Bracey to introduce our students.
Thank you, Mr. Parent. Before we get to the students, I would like to recognize some students that are assisting us this evening. First, we have our core students under direction of Ms. Robin Duncan. We have Tawan Hales, Travis Goodwin, Kimaria Patterson, Ebony Savage. Our orchestra students under direction of Ms. Amy Coxwell, Lawrence Jones, Logan Brindle, Barbara Toussaint, Olivia Parker. Our ROTC color guard under the direction of Lieutenant Colonel Paul Pratt and Gunny Sergeant Larry Nash. We have cadets Chloe Graham, David Justice, Trevor Hanel, and Andrew Loyola. At this time, we have the color guard in front of us. And we will have our pledge once they are set. The two students that we have coming tonight, we have Montavious Trayvon Gatlin and Maggie Beth McGinley. First, Montavious, he's a senior at Churchland High School. He has a 4.21 cumulative GPA. He has been an active member of the Robotics Club for 3 years. During the summer, he participated in the Advanced Manufacturing Summer Academy sponsored by ECPI University, where he had an opportunity to pursue his interest in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. He serves as a junior marshal. He is also a member of the National Foreign Language Honor Society and the National English Honor Society. He plans to attend the University of Virginia, where he wants to pursue a bachelor's degree in engineering. He's the son of Monte Gatlin Sr. and Lenora Gatlin. And if his parents are present tonight, will they please stand? And Maggie Beth McGinley, she is a student athlete and leader at Churchland High School, where she is a senior. She has a 3.95 cumulative GPA. She is an advanced placement scholar, an active member of the National Honor Society, and takes classes at Tidewater Community College. She is the captain of both the swim and scholastic bowl teams. She contributed over 40 volunteer hours during the 2015-16 school year. She is the co-founder of the Churchland High School Environmental Action Club, an organization dedicated to saving the environment. She is the president of the Student Council Association. She plans to attend the College of William and Mary in Virginia. Her career goal is to become a neurosurgeon. She is the daughter of Dave and Sandra McGinley. And if they are present, will they stand and be recognized? I think what we will have first, we'll have the, we have our students here that are going to sing the national anthem for us. And then we'll, after that, we'll do the pledge. You may be seated. And as Maggie comes forward, I would like to take this time to recognize the administration at Churchland High School, Mr. Sean Malachi, the principal, Mr. Eric Garcia, assistant principal, Ms. Ana Maria Incremenius, assistant principal, Mr. Mark Lindenberg, assistant principal, and Mr. Kenneth B. Austin III, dean of students.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. My name is Maggie McGinley, and I'm a senior at Churchland High School. I'm proud to say this because Churchland has proven its excellence time and time again. The enriching academic environment found here continually provides students with an excellent education and opportunities. Churchland High is fully accredited, boasts an impressive 96% on-time graduation rate, and SOL scores that are above the state average. Churchland offers a wide array of courses to ensure that every student has the tools necessary to achieve their goals. We host the AC13 horticulture program, as well as offer many advanced placement classes, and have a partnership with Tidewater Community College that gives Churchland students a distinctive edge. Churchland High's spirit of competition gives dimension to our academically successful students. Last year, we earned the U.S. News & World Report's Best High Schools Bronze Award for the second consecutive year, and we're determined to exceed our high standards to win it again. Our robotics team brought home the gold last year in the VEX Robotics Competition, and our DECA members placed first in multiple competitions at the most recent DECA Leadership Conference. Our athletic teams met incredible success, as always, for the 2015-16 season. Most notably, our boys volleyball team was a runner-up for the regional championships. The boys soccer team secured a position as Conference 17 champions, and our girls track teams, both indoor and outdoor, had runners attain state champion levels. While our athletic teams have achieved many successes, their spotlight is shared by the Visual and Performing Arts program. Kirtland is the home of the Center of Excellence for the Arts Magnet program, which gives our artistic students many opportunities to showcase their talents and thrive. Our more musical students, who have also demonstrated their talents by winning first place for band, percussion, music, and color guard at the Tidewater Festival of Marching Bands. Our concert band has also received excellent ratings at the District 4 Concert Band Assessment. On top of all of these successes, what I've always admired about CHS is how lively our student body is after the last bell rings. The array of clubs and extracurricular activities offered at Churchland is expansive, and each one has a tangible impact on our school and community. Students can develop their leadership and workplace readiness skills through DECA or FBLA, plan volunteer opportunities to the National Honor Society, or test their knowledge during quiz bowl practice. Most of our clubs were created by students, like the Environmental Action Club, Pause Club, and Debate Club. There are many limitless options for Churchland students to expand their horizons beyond the classroom. As students, we couldn't dream of achieving our goals without the support of the exceptional teachers and staff here at Churchland. The features that make Churchland amazing, its academic records, its clubs, its sports teams, are all made possible by a group of caring, talented, and dedicated professionals. They stand at the ready to help students succeed, whether through after-school tutoring or serving as mentors. Our teachers and staff are simply the best. Through them, Churchland High achieves excellence, and its halls become a community of success. This sense of community is what sets us apart, and it's the quality of Churchland of which I am most proud. We invite you to return. I guarantee that you will discover for yourself the dynamic atmosphere of Churchland High School. Thank you.
Students, if you will remain there, Mrs. Hines has a presentation.
Montavious and Maggie, thank you so much for being here tonight, for being a representative of Churchland High School. Thank you for making Portsmouth proud, and I know both of you will do great things at the University of Virginia. Thank you so much, Montavious. And at William and Mary.
Good evening. Thanks for allowing Churchland High School to host this event. I think it's great to get out in the community, and we are more than happy to host it. Thank you, parents and community members, for coming out. In front of you, board members, you'll find a token of appreciation from us on behalf of our admin team, our school, our two wonderful students that are here. Within the bag, along with the token, you'll find a personalized card. As you know, October is Disability Awareness Month. Within each bag, that card was made by one of my most favorite classes, Ms. Sebastian's special needs class. It's a class that I visit every single day. I run with them once a week. I tell them I'll run with them in the gym. That's all I've got in me. But they have created a card, a personalized card for each of you. And as well, the gift in there. We invite you to come out and to Churchland High School, and that goes out to everybody. As you've heard, we've got so many awesome things going on. Tomorrow night, in fact, we will play host to IC Norcom High School in a rivalry Portsmouth game. So we invite you all to come out and join us on this Saturday. We also have a Conference 17 cheerleading tournament. So please come out to one of those events or one of the many events that we'll have throughout the school year. And again, thanks for allowing us to host.
Thank you very much for hosting. At this time, we'll have the school board mission statement by Mrs. Hines. Mrs. Hines.
The mission of the Portsmouth Public School Division is to engage all students in learning that will foster academic excellence and responsible citizenship.
Thank you. At this time, Madam Clerk, attendance, it's not through electronic vote, but would you call attendance, please?
Mr. Bridgeford.
Present.
Reverend Fleming.
Present.
Mrs. Hines.
Present.
Mr. Nance.
Here.
Reverend Patillo.
Present.
Dr. Whitaker.
Present.
Mrs. Williams.
Here.
Mr. Parent.
Here.
Eight members present, one member absent.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is the approval of the agenda. We are moving 10.1, which is discipline case number 2016-17/04, to item 3.8, which will be the next item on the agenda.
Move for approval as amended.
Second.
Motion's been made. Second. Any discussion? Hearing no discussion. Madam Clerk.
Mr. Bridgeford.
Yes.
Reverend Fleming.
Yes.
Mrs. Hines.
Yes.
Mr. Nance.
Yes.
Reverend Patillo.
Yes.
Dr. Whitaker.
Yes.
Mrs. Williams.
Yes.
Mr. Parent.
Yes.
It's unanimous.
Thank you. Discipline case number 2016-17/04. The recommendation is suspend for time served. What is the board's pleasure?
Move for approval.
Second.
Motion's been made and second. Any discussion? Hearing no discussion. Madam Clerk, roll call vote, please.
Mr. Bridgeford.
Yes.
Reverend Fleming.
Yes.
Mrs. Hines.
Yes.
Mr. Nance.
Yes.
Reverend Patillo.
Yes.
Dr. Whitaker.
Yes.
Mrs. Williams.
Yes.
Mr. Parent.
Yes.
It's unanimous.
Thank you. At this time, we move on to public comment, non-agenda items. We do have a number of people that are going to be speaking tonight. Madam Clerk.
The Portsmouth City School Board is always interested in hearing from the citizens of its community. If you have registered to speak prior to this meeting, the clerk will call your name when it is your turn to address the school board. If you have not registered prior to the meeting, you may be given an opportunity to speak by the chairman after the first group has been called by the clerk. When speaking, please keep your comments focused on issues that are of general interest to the school division and the community. This public comments period is for non-agenda items only. Due to the length of our meetings, the school board requires that you keep your comments to 5 minutes. An additional few minutes may be granted by the chairman. Ms. Carolyn Cannon.
Dr. Bracy, school board members, good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for the opportunity to come before you on behalf of the IC Norcom High School Marching Band and its band parents. The band is in need of funding to continuously engage our youth who are interested in the fine arts in activities which keep them focused on the positive aspects of an educational experience. The marching band is a viable part of the school's composition, as well as the city of Portsmouth and the state of Virginia. It has achieved many accomplishments throughout the years while being a shining star for our public school system. The band needs your support to ensure that our children continue to be participants and that it will continue to exist. It is often an added hardship for most parents to provide monetary support so that their child can participate. Once band dues was eliminated this year, membership increased by 24 students. How many more children in our school would like to be a part of the band, but the lack of money denies them the opportunity? Also noted is that there are no fees incurred for other sports-related activities, while the band enhances them all with its performances, but must incur expenses for its participation. Is one activity more important than another? I think not. Funding on a continuous basis to provide transportation, uniforms, instruments, and their upkeep, accommodations for nationals, personal needs, and other basic essentials is needed. Though parents have struggled and sacrificed through fundraisers and monetary donations to provide the necessary items to get the band started for this year, the band is in dire straits of funding for nationals in Atlanta, Georgia, November 11th through the 13th, 2016. It is our desire that funding be incorporated in the school board's budget for each forthcoming year in support of the band. We also emphasize, as noted in the budget proposal presented and detailed to each of you, that the remaining two high schools within our city be considered in a like manner. They are all our future. If it isn't possible to meet the entire proposed budget amount, whatever you can do to alleviate the hardship will be appreciated immensely. Thank you for your time and immediate attention to our current and future requests.
Thank you, Ms. Cannon.
Mrs. Canyon, I agree wholeheartedly. I am one that definitely believes that a student should not have to sit out from participating in an activity because they can't afford the fees associated with that activity. And as a public school system, we should do all that we can to make sure that students, that activities receive the funding that they need so that parents don't have to come out of pocket for their students to participate. And I think the 24 students that did join the band once the fees were set aside, that's an inspiration. And that's something that we need to know about. Now, I know that we often say that the district is strapped in terms of funding for some of these things, but I think we have to make it a priority. And it's not just for, as you said, Norcom, but all of the schools across the district. We need to know what is needed, for what it's needed, and do our best to try to ensure that students can participate in these things. You have scholarships on the line. Students do go to colleges and universities on band scholarships. And also we know that extracurricular activities tend to help improve academic performance in schools. So I thank you very much for coming out tonight and for presenting this to us. Thank you.
You're more than welcome. Thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, next speaker.
Mr. Robert DePue. Okay. Mrs. Brenda Joseph.
First, I want to say something good.
Thank you.
First, I want to say something good about the school system before I say all the negative things. My grandson went to Mount Hermon for pre-K, then went to Church and Primary 1 through 3rd grade. The last 4 weeks, he had moved to Virginia Beach, but he stayed in Portsmouth Schools. The first 2 weeks in Virginia Beach, the school gave a test. Everybody in his room scored over 400. He scored over 800. That shows that we do have some good teachers.
Absolutely. Thank you.
But for some reason, Michael can't get a good teacher. Dr. Bracy, you were wrong when you told me I should have started sooner and the principal should have started sooner. I've been fighting this school system 4 years for this child. I've been through Stuckwish. I've been through Dr. Fisher. And it's just not been one time a year I've been down here or downtown a lot of times. On his program that he's supposed to have now, they're supposed to modify his assignments. They're giving him the full load like the rest of the students. He was the other night 5 hours doing homework. That's way too long for sixth grade. And so far, he's brought some F's home, bringing home if he's getting the help he needs. And the ones that he's been bringing home that has been good, he tells me they're giving him the answers. That's not helping him a bit. I put in for a transfer. For some reason, I was turned down. I'm not putting in a transfer for him to go to the schools that I went to, but Sixth Avenue is an apartment building now. Harry A. Hunt Junior High has been gone, and Woodrow Wilson is gone. But someone on this school board that used to be on the school board that's on the city council now, he wanted his children to go to his school. He put in for a zone waiver, and it got approved. Why can't my zone waiver get approved? I talked to your secretary Tuesday. She said she was going to give Dr. Teller my name and phone number so she could call me about the zone waiver. I haven't heard from her. It's time this school gave this one child an education. You're giving it to his sister. His sister's A honor roll, and she's running for president at Churchland Middle School this year. So she has it down, but he doesn't have it down. He needs extra help, and I'm asking you to go against that zone waiver and put him in Churchland Academy, where everybody in the neighborhood tells him it's better there, and give him a chance to get an education, because you know as it is, he's already 2 years behind. He don't need to get behind anymore. Thank you.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, next speaker.
Ms. Danielle Moore.
Board members.
Good evening.
I just wanted to get up and kind of share my story in reference to being a mother of, excuse me, a teenager that's in the Portsmouth School District. He's a senior now and he's attending Churchland High. And my issue is the suspensions in Portsmouth and the suspensions period in the school. I think it's a process. We really have to fight hard as parents to kind of get through, and the officials are not listening to the kids. My son has never been in trouble his whole 4 years in high school. He's a senior this year. He worked very hard to keep up his grades so that he can actually join the varsity baseball team. There was an incident this past spring that got him suspended for school. The officials really didn't listen to his side of the story. They just assumed that his involvement was so severe that they actually, he was subject to a 10-day suspension and an administrative hearing in order to come back to Churchland, or he was gonna be referred to an alternative school. At the end of the day, my son was only trying to break up a fight. And me personally speaking to the vice principal at that time, they failed to let me review any evidence that states that my son was, or basically proved my son's involvement in this. The principal at the time, which was just, I guess he was sitting in, said that it was his hands were tied and there was nothing that he can do. But I went over their heads and actually spoke to someone in the superintendent's office, explained the story to her, and I'm gonna tell you right now that social media is our friend. Because if it wasn't for the two boys that actually were engaged in this altercation, my son would have been looking at a 10-day suspension on his record. His grades would have went back down, and he would have basically would have ruined everything that he worked so hard to achieve in school. So I think you guys need to probably really take a look into the suspensions and kind of the procedures and listen to these kids. And it shouldn't be this hard for us parents to actually, you know, get something done within the school system. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, next speaker.
Ms. Crystal Harrison.
I want to thank the board for having us here today and allowing us to speak. I'm speaking on behalf of my family and my son. My son was recently suspended over 2 weeks ago from Wilson High School. He was bullied and then got into a fight. He was suspended for 10 days, and then he had to go in front of the board, actually the committee, the behavior committee, to see if my son could return back to Wilson High School or to the alternative school. At that point, that's all I thought we were there for, until they decided to expel my son. My son has never been in any altercations in high school or at home. He has never been suspended for any violent things, only because he was tardy a few times, and I know that's a big deal too. But my son is an honor roll student, or was when he was suspended. Today makes the 11th day. We still have not heard anything from the board when our next meeting will be to decide if you guys are going to allow my son to return back to the public school or if he's going to be completely expelled. He's 15 years old. He plays sports for Wilson in the baseball and basketball teams. He's also being looked at two colleges who are trying to scout my son for baseball. And I'm just asking that the no tolerance policy that you guys have, you can bend it, waiver it, look into the situation, because Mr. Hillich at that school never asked my son how the fight began. I tried to bring my son in a few days afterwards to talk to him about it. He still did not want to hear how the fight began. He just said it's zero tolerance. He was in a fight. He gets 10 days. No one has answered any of my questions about where my son's going to go or what my son's going to do at this point. He is 15 years old. He is sitting at home. This makes the 11th day. And I just need the board to do something to help us parents. Us parents who children may get in an altercation in school, and we understand you have to take whatever comes with the circumstances, and I truly understand that. But what do we do as parents at home when our children are sitting there? What do we do when people are shutting their eyes to us and telling us, you can't do anything, you need to just sit and wait? I can't sit and wait. My son's education is more important than anything else in this entire world, and I don't know what to do at this point. Everything is high. Everyone's telling me, sit and wait for the board, sit and wait for this, sit and wait for that. Well, now it's the 11th day. I know if he is allowed to return back to Wilson High School, my son is not going to have 3 A's and a B anymore. It's just not going to be there. With all the schoolwork that he's missed and all the time he's missed, as well as all the games he's missed and the scouts that are sitting here watching him, he's only a sophomore. He has 2 more years left, and I just need the board to reconsider the zero tolerance. I do understand that I do have the support and backup of the Virginia organizing. If it weren't for them, I wouldn't have known about this meeting. I wouldn't have known about what to do and how I can speak up for my child. I do need y'all to take that into consideration. There is a lot of us parents out here whose children have been suspended, and for numerous reasons. Maybe bring in a cell phone and gets a 3-day suspension for that. Maybe the kid was tardy and they get a 3-day suspension for that. Just numerous suspensions that's just not making any sense. If y'all can reconsider it, start thinking about different ways or ways that we can help our kids when they are home. Give them still a chance to stay educated and not fall behind, because we're setting them up for the pipeline to prison. That's what we're doing. And if we don't have a solution or make a solution and a change right now, these kids are not going to make it. If we don't educate them, the street will. And everybody knows, once a child is victim to the street, he's into the system forever. I don't know what y'all can do. I have no clue, but I do know this is my first step to see if we can make some kind of change, if we can take these kids individually, because a fight don't just happen. There's a reason, a cause. It starts from one place to another, or maybe if a kid is tardy, there's gotta be a reason. If they would just take the chance to talk to the child and suspend and give the proper, whatever needs to be done for the situation properly, each individual child, and then look at the circumstances and look what this child has to offer. Look what they've done. Look at their schoolwork. Look at these schools looking at them. Look at all their commitments in the school. FBLA, my son was selected to go to Virginia Tech for 3 days for a business meeting at the end of this month. Mr. Hillich told me my son could not go anymore. And he was chosen in that school. We've had over 2,400
Excuse me, Ms. Harrison, you've got 4 seconds to wrap it up, please.
Okay. Well, there's been over 2,400 individual students suspended in the last year, which is an increase of 200 students from the year before. I'm just asking that y'all take the suspensions into consideration.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Ms. Harrison, just a minute. I think Dr. Bracey would like to make a comment.
Yes, Ms. Harrison, your case, as you mentioned, is in for an appeal.
Yes.
And the letter, I sh- should be in the mail. If you haven't received it, you should be receiving it soon, because I know they did go out. So at that time, you will be afforded an opportunity for a formal hearing at that time. Okay. And then the board will hear the case.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Mr. Nance.
Mr. Chair, it appears that we've got some more speakers from Wilson High School. It's quite out of the ordinary for us to hear a potential expulsion case prior to, since the board will have to be the judging body of this. So if it has to deal with this case, any of the future speakers, we need to ask them to refrain from it, please. And I don't usually like to limit public comment, but Mr. Meekins.
Mr. Meekins.
This comes with experience, I guess, Mr. Meekins, that we're really not supposed to be talking about a case that's pending before us.
Well, certainly you are not allowed to discuss this case in any way, shape, manner, or form. There's a process for addressing grievances regarding disciplinary actions in schools. My understanding is, and I believe it emphatically, that everyone who has suffered a disciplinary action is advised of their rights to note their appeal. Those are procedural due process rights that are set forth in booklets, pamphlets, students' codes, and in the Virginia Code. On the other hand, sir, I cannot tell people that they cannot speak on topics that they want to address. I can just tell them,
order.
All I can say is that they do risk prejudicing the case, because there's not going to, these cases involve evidence, and it's not a matter of just emotional appeal.
So there's nothing to prohibit speakers speaking if they're involved in these.
They believe that's what they want to do in regard to this. I know of no way to prohibit them.
Okay.
And that's fine. I didn't want to limit anyone's right to speak, Ms. Harrison. Don't get me wrong. I just did not want any. I'm speaking, okay? Any violation of procedure at this point, okay? To afford your child the due process that he's due, okay? So don't take that as offense. I just didn't want any prejudicial type thing going on here, okay?
Wait a minute. We cannot have.
We can't address you there, but I was just
Dr.
telling
Whitaker.
You, I'm not trying to limit your speech. I just don't want anyone who happens to be here about the same case to potentially prejudice the case. Thank you.
Dr. Whitaker.
Yes, Ms. Harrison, I did want to comment on a couple of things that you said. This board is very much concerned with the suspension issue, and it's something that we discuss all the time. So we are cognizant of it, and we're working on it. One of the other things that you mentioned was that we have children in the school system that need help, and I agree. And with that said, in order to help children effectively, we need money. We need money for programs. We need money for social workers. That's something that I've advocated for. We don't have social workers in the school. One of my suggestions is that you not only lobby us as a school board, but that you go to city council meetings as well and demand that they fund the schools adequately. And I think that's something that as an organization you need to take into consideration as well. Thank you.
Madam Clerk, next speaker.
Mrs. Sergio Neal.
Good evening, Dr. Bracey, and members of the school board and citizens and parents of Portsmouth, Virginia. My name is Sergio Neal. I am a member of Virginia Organizer, and I actually have a different task tonight. I'm not coming to fuss, quote unquote, tonight. I'm actually coming to offer some thanks to a couple of individuals that we failed to thank at the last school board meeting for their effort in helping us bridge the communication gap. First of all, Mrs. Kathleen Chambers, thank you so much for all that you do for us. We know we bombard you with so much information. She's always very receptive to us. She receives our information. She gets it to where it needs to go. And any questions that we have, she's always willing to answer. And we thank you so much. The reception staff at the school board office, they always do the same thing. You know, anytime we have any concerns, they do their best to mediate those and get us to where we need to go. So we just wanted to offer our thanks to all of the staff, people who stand in the gap with that communication, getting it to the school board members, getting our information to Dr. Bracey or Dr. Sandlin or whoever it needs to go to. We just want to thank those people because we realize how important and how hard their job is already with the demands that the school system puts on them. And then when we have community organizations come in and put in extra demands, you know, it's just the process. So from our organization to you, Ms. Kathy Chambers, to you, Ms. Stewart, I know I've talked to her before, and everybody else, we just want to offer our utmost thanks to all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, next speaker.
Ms. Dana Harrison.
How y'all doing today? Dr. Bracey, school board members, and parents and Portsmouth citizens, thank you for listening today. Okay, thank you. Thank you, school board and Dr. Bracey, for continuing to be receptive and work with the community on the important issues of the school discipline and suspensions. We received your information from our FOIA request as it pertains to the total suspensions of last school year and September of this school year. We also took the information from the Department of Education on specific types of suspensions and comparisons between school years, which I have for each of you that we passed out. According to the data you sent to us, Portsmouth gave out 4,950 suspensions last year to a total of 2,240 students. Now, I think we all know that's exceptionally high, and I hope that we can fix that. In September of this year, Portsmouth schools gave out 257 suspensions. If we keep on this track like that, the total for 2016-2017 would be about 2,300 suspensions, a remarkable decrease from the years prior. However, we do need to keep seeing the numbers of suspensions monthly to see if any time of the years are troublesome, such as during the SOLs or at the end of the semester when students might get a little restless. We request that you continue to keep the public aware on the number of suspensions each month. Additionally, our group, Virginia Organizing, has come up with the revised list of recommendations based on our meeting with each of you, which is also in the packet I gave you. They include, number one, Student Bracey gives monthly public announcements of suspension data at school board meetings, including the schools who fared the best and the worst in terms of reducing suspensions and why. Number two, the school board will set up a therapeutic restorative in school suspension programs. Number three, VEA cultural competence training for all administrative staff and teachers annually. Number four, character building classes for students included in curriculum. Number five, Superintendent Bracey will set up a partnership with an outside organization to run a parent advocate program in which volunteers will help guide parents through the process of working with the disciplinary board and MDR hearings for students with disabilities. Number six, the school board will end zero tolerance policies and across the board suspensions for disciplinary infractions that do not threaten school safety. Students will be suspended on an individual basis is what we're looking for. And number seven, when it is found necessary to suspend a student, all of their homework for the day suspended will be provided to the teachers. Thank you very much for continuing to work with us on these important issues.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, next speaker, please.
Ms. Velma McDonald. Ms. Charlotte Scott.
Good evening, school board and parents.
Pardon? Okay.
My name is Charlotte Scott, and I grew up in Portsmouth. on Effingham Street across from the big water tower, next door to the shipyard. There's still a lot of families there, and we're having the problem that I'm concerned about is the fact that these children have been exposed to lead and asbestos, which attack their nervous systems and their brains. There are a number of programs available through the Anyway, I've talked with some of the parents here, and I wanted to be here and look at your faces so that I could see who is impeding the opportunity for these children. I was told by Charles Whitehurst a while before he passed, when I asked him, what do you intend to do about these children? I mean, the ones in Southside Garden, Hope Village, and the locations from Portsmouth Boulevard down to South Street, from First Street over to Elm Avenue. This is around the tower. Those children, Charles told me, had been doomed. For a person to be doomed, all hope and opportunity has to be removed. So I wanted to look at the faces of the school board that was allowing the school system to treat these children as though they are behavioral problems rather than the medical issues that they have. These carcinogens and teratogens that are airborne and come through stormwater runoff from the shipyard to these children, that they have not, no regulations have been made. There is a program called Mother to Baby. And I don't have money to have all of these, to have these copies made and one for each one of you guys. But there are I have the phone numbers, I have the addresses, I have the names. I will be glad to furnish them for you. And any of these parents that are here that might have children with those problems, they receive an irresistible impulse. They receive from the brain to do or commit a certain action. I grew up down there too, so you can see how it has affected me, and is why I'm so concerned about the children that are now there. You are suspending them from school, causing them educational problems. I was told by one of the parents that the school board had said that they didn't have money for a program for ADD children. So what do you propose that they do? They're supposed to be a lead test given at the age of 1 to 2. They're supposed to receive their first lead level blood test. And that I spoke with the state health department. They said they don't test. It goes to their private doctor and then is monitored by the health department, by the doctor. I mean, through the doctor.
Excuse me, Mrs. Scott, you have 30 seconds, please. Thank you.
Okay. Something has to be done about these children. It was discovered, the lead was discovered 20 years ago on those locations. Those families are still there. The city has rezoned those communities from residential to industrial. So the children are becoming more and more contaminated. They are becoming, having, their issues are growing. Okay, so I propose that what was done with my grandson, we changed his diet, we changed his schedules and his activities. At second grade, they had wanted to put him into alternative school. And we worked with him and some of the teachers that were willing to work with him. He is now graduating next year on the honor roll, made honor roll this year. So it's possible for ADD children to improve, but it requires care.
I'm sorry, Ms. Scott, your time is up unless the board would like to give you 30 more seconds. What is the pleasure of the board? All right, you have 30 more seconds. Go ahead.
I want to tell you about the mother-to-baby program. It's in Washington, D.C. And it's in New York. And it gives you, you'll have a number that you can call, or the parents can call, and ask questions about what they can expect, what kind of options do they have, what kind of treatments can be afforded these children. And this is something that was put upon them, you know. And like I said, 20 years ago, it was established that these sites were lead and asbestos contaminated. At least 2 more generations have been born there, and is known to be one of the worst parts of town. This is due to the attack to the nervous system and the brain, a medical problem, which does cause a behavioral problem, but has to be given special consideration.
Thank you, Ms. Scott. Appreciate it. Madam Clerk?
Ms. Crystal Nolan.
Good evening, school board members, fellow citizens and parents. I come to you today. My name is Crystal Nolan. I've been in education a little over 20 years. A large portion of that time was spent in special education. I come in support of Mrs. Charlotte Scott and her initiative to have the families that reside in those toxic areas relocated. I think it is something that we are charged to do. We are neglectful if we do anything less. Our children clearly are our futures. And I was educated in Portsmouth public school systems, and I have lived in some of the worst poverty level and below poverty level neighborhoods in the city. So I'm very concerned that one day when I look to the leadership for this great historic place that is a link and a bridge between many different industries, and it has a very prominent place in the running of our international, our global communities, I'm afraid that our children won't have the opportunity to participate, that I won't see myself reflected in those children because of the toxic environment that the children are living in. It does affect, and it causes a sickness of the mind, and it evidences itself in behavior issues and in activity that can sometimes be looked at as violent and then criminal. As the mother made the very strong statement, the pipeline to prison. That is how many of our ill children are treated. They're criminalized, and it's not right, and it's not fair. And we cannot be neglectful with our future generations. I would love to hear that you all have some type of long-term agenda or plan in conglomeration, in cooperation with the public health services for the city. But it definitely is an issue, and it's definitely something that we cannot neglect for the benefit and the health and the safety of our children and ourselves. And that's all I would like to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Madam Clerk, do we have any other speakers?
If there are any additional speakers, you may request permission to speak from the board at this time.
Dr. Bracey, do you have any comments? Oh, okay.
Hi, my name is Nadasha Satterwhite. My son was one of the students suspended at Woodrow Wilson. I just want to say that, first of all, I come all this way to see even what was the reason. You know, I'm not aware of what he is up for expulsion for. I just received the letter that it was called mob, and also that it was starting a riot. I try to talk to someone, and I haven't had answers about what happened. All that was requested to do was to come to a placement hearing for my son to be expelled from school. I just want to say, to me, it's like a conspiracy on the students that was suspended. I feel like the story that's being...
Mr. Chairman. We're starting to hear something. We've already heard a name, and that's a little bit too much.
Yep.
We try to keep the name of the student in privacy, yep. And now it's being called, and we're leading to some of the evidence of whatever this case may be.
Okay. What he's saying I'm refraining from that. Using any names at this.
Okay. Did I say my son's name, or what name did I say?
Go ahead.
Oh, I didn't hear me say a name, but okay. Like I said, my concern is that a lot of those students are being punished for a conspiracy against them. And I just want y'all to understand that we don't know, these parents here tonight really don't know what happened, and that's why we push to come forward way here. You know, we just want answers, an explanation of what happened, because it's not adding up with what they're saying, you know. And I do take great initiative of my son's education, and I just want fairness, you know. I'm aware of what he done. It's some disciplinary action, but I just feel like it's harsh, especially with not knowing as a parent what's going on. So, you know, I understand y'all say it's a letter coming out, and we have, you know, we can talk about it further then, but I just wanted to say that to y'all tonight.
Thank you.
All right.
Mrs. Williams.
Thank you, Chairman Parent. I guess my question is for the superintendent. When your son was suspended,
yes,
did the school contact you or?
They did contact me to pick him up, and all they stated was he was involved in a fight. Okay. And that he was being suspended.
Okay. I just wondered because it... Right.
Yeah.
I just wondered because you said you didn't know what happened and you hadn't talked with anyone. And I know the standard procedure is that they are supposed to contact the parents. So.
Yes. And it just was for pickup, basically. When I asked for further information, they told me they were still investigating. And I never got any... explanation of the reason till I went to the placement committee, and then I received a suspension notice 2 days after, and that's when I knew what exactly he was suspended for. You know, I didn't know it was so severe, you know, until I received the letter.
Mr. Meekins, do you have our attorney?
Ladies and gentlemen of the school board, discipline, student discipline is a private matter between the student and the school division. You are not allowed to discuss that in public.
Right.
There is no advantage to discussing it in public. I am sure the due process rights have been provided. I would encourage you not to engage in a discussion about student discipline because the child's privacy is the most important thing.
Okay. Thank you.
Could I say one more thing?
Yeah.
I understand that it's the student's privacy, but how much privacy when the parent don't even know what's going on? You know, I feel like that's a little too much privacy.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Madam Clerk?
There are no more speakers.
Next item on the agenda is public comment. Oh, Dr. Bracey, did you want to make a comment? Dr. Bracey?
Thank you, Chairman Parent. Just to follow up from the discussion and with the Virginia Organizing Group, I know that we have worked with them to try to provide information that they've asked for. And I know Mr. Neal has contacted me before with a request to for meetings, and that was granted. And I guess, you know, month after month, I see that they're still concerned. So what I would like to offer to you, Mr. Neal, is to be able to attend. I'm asking for an invitation to attend your meetings. So that way I can come and address questions in a more open format. You know, there are certain things that I can't discuss, but I would love to be there to address some of the questions. I know some of the members have questions and concerns that can't make it to the board meeting, so I have no problem coming to your sessions. I think we want the same thing. You know, we want all of our kids in school, because if they're not in school, they're not going to be successful on the end of course test. So we want them in school. So we need to talk about why they're not in school and what all of us can do to keep them in school. And I think we talked about that. And I think we all agreed that certain infractions require suspensions, but truly not all suspensions. All infractions do that. We understand that. So I think we need to have a more in-depth dialogue. You know, I'll come to you. You won't have to come to me, but I think we need to do that. And like I said, if you tell me when your meetings are, then if I'm available, I would love to come, because I think the more open and more dialogue that we have about it, you will understand where we are, and I can share with the board what your concerns are. So if you will contact Ms. Patterson tomorrow and give her your schedule, and she will set that up with mine so that we can exchange dialogue. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Bracey. The next item on the agenda is public comment board agenda items. Do we have any speakers?
No.
All right. The next item on the agenda is the student representative report.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Currently, we are working on the system to get information from all of our schools, but until then, Portsmouth Elementary Schools, Middle Schools, and one of its high schools, IC Norcom, are currently involved in a nationwide program called PBIS, which is short for Positive Behavior Intervention and Supports. This is in place to encourage students to make better decisions. Since the establishment of this program in the schools, there have been positive changes in student place for this program. Norcom uses incentives such as Greyhound Bucks, which are given out when students are exhibiting safe, responsible, honorable, and leader-like behavior. This is a Greyhound Buck I have received, and with it, I could put it toward a senior due or another thing that they would allow me to do. And we use a really cool acronym, which the students use in everyday language, which is SWAG. It stands for Safety First, Work Together, Accept Responsibility, and Guide Me.
Thank you. Good job. The next item on the agenda is presentations. Dr. Bracey, WHRO Educational Service.
Thank you, Chairman Parent. And as Mr. Bert Smith, if you will come forward, and WHRO, as you know, is a partner with Portsmouth Public Schools, and Mr. Smith will talk about some of the partnership agreements that we have and the wonderful things that we benefit from. So welcome tonight, Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Dr. Bracey, members of the school board. Thank you for allowing me to speak with you today. My name is Bert Schmidt, president of WHRO. With me is Brian Callahan, my vice president of education. You have in front of you, I do believe, a hard copy of the annual impact statement we provide you each year. We come to you every other year. And before I get into this, I just want to note a lot of the items I'm going to talk about today are virtual learning tools that you have. So when you're talking about kids that aren't in school for whatever reason, there may be some solutions buried within these my talking points. So just something to think about. Won't cost you an extra penny and might help you work out some of the issues it sounds like you may be having. So getting back into my report, page number one, this is your leadership here in the school division. You've got, of course, Keith Nance, represents the board. Thank you, Keith, for all your work representing the school at the ownership meetings. Of course, Dr. Bracey meets with the other 18 school divisions that own WHRO. Dean, thank you for all your work. In fact, Dean is now chair of the Technology Advisory Council. We got him somehow to do that work. So, and Phil Hines has been very active. So you've got great leadership from Portsmouth working with WHRO. Page number two, our educator resources and training. eMedia VA is an online repository of digital learning objects. These can be videos, audios, games, apps, lesson plans. We have over 125,000 learning objects, all correlated to the Virginia Standards of Learning. This is free. This can be used in the school. It can be used at home. It's alternative assessments. There's a lot of material in here that can be used by parents, by students, by teachers. You have it for free. It's within the division, and we would encourage that usage. In fact, the General Assembly, we have a contract with Richmond Department of Education. They doubled our funding this year, so we have more staff available for training of your teachers, for marketing materials. And so, again, eMedia VA, we've had this built for about 5 or 6 years now upon request of the schools. And it is a great way for students to learn various SOL topics through digital, where it's the space they're living in. Skipping to item three, online professional development, we have our teacher line service offers graduate credit and recertification for your teachers. Six of your teachers took advantage of that. Item number five, we have now gotten into the workforce development space in a significant way. We have a website called Skills Online. We have over 4,000 courses in 18 different industry sectors. We're going to actually add GED this year to the program, all available online. Again, going off script a little bit because it's not in this report, we have a program that we have partnered with StoryCorps. StoryCorps is a national program on NPR, on my radio stations, to talk about their lives. What we created is a school version of that called StoryCorps U, where teachers and students come together and talk about their lives together. So teachers understand students better, students understand teachers better. It's been used in a number of divisions in this area, and it's been rolling out nationally, so schools around the country are starting to use this program. Something to think about. If you'd like to talk more, we can talk offline about that. I'm going to skip now to page four, our student services. As I hope you all know, we have developed a number of online courses for you, high school courses. In page four, that second paragraph lists the courses, including algebra, trig, astronomy, biology, chemistry, earth science, economics and personal finance, English 9, 10, 11, and 12, geometry, health and PE 9 and 10, math analysis, oceanography, physics, U.S. history, U.S. and Virginia government, world geography, world history 1 and 2, along with an online teaching methodology course. This past year, we added French and psychology. We also revised, because of the SOLs, Virginia and U.S. history, Virginia and U.S. government, and English 9 and 11. And we created, upon request of the superintendents, a digital citizenship module, kind of a chapter of a course. which is focused in middle school areas and teaching students how to be appropriate online. Etiquette, safety, you know, all those kind of issues that students deal with when they start using the internet as extensively as middle schoolers do. We've made it, we give all this to you, and you use them however your policy dictates. But you have all of this, all of these items. Item 2 on page 4 is Virtual Virginia. That's the state's advanced placement world language program. We've been operating that for the state for over 10 years now. Last year, the state decided to have a full-time program. That means a student takes 5 or more courses online. Last year, they did a pilot with 100 students. This year, it's a pilot with 200 students. Last year, 2 of your students did a full-time online program. What's nice about this is if you have a homeschooler that wants to take an online course, if they take it through Virtual Virginia, through the division, you actually get the ADM for that homeschooler. That's not the way it's been working in the past. Obviously, a homeschooler, you're not getting credit for. But if a homeschooler takes a Virtual Virginia full-time program, you'll get ADM for that student. And then, of course, some of those issues between the schools and homeschoolers kind of go away. So something to think about. Page 5, additional educational resources. This is where we like to celebrate smart kids. I'm going to skip right to number 2, our writers PBS Kids Writer Contest. Kids K through 5. They write a story, they illustrate the story, they put it in for a competition. We actually take the winners and we animate those stories and we make a television show out of it. So you know, your little young students can see these creations come to life on TV. It's a pretty cool experience. We love to have Portsmouth participate in that. Item 3, the Spelling Bee. Many of you hopefully have watched the Spelling Bee. We've been broadcasting that for, I guess it's coming up on the 10th year this year. Last year, Churchill Middle and West Haven Elementary School champs were in the Bee. The champion goes to the National Spelling Bee in Washington. And item number 4, for over 30 years, WHRO has been doing the Great Computer Challenge. Right. Teams of students from K to 12 compete in the various programming languages. You can see your students competed in desktop publishing, graphic design, and others. Next page, page 6. We have a number of video productions, and Dr. Bracey, we're going to be calling you soon to get you on our Education Now spots. If you watch WHRO, you'll see between the shows, we highlight best practices of school divisions. And so, you know, Dr. Suckwich, back in the day, was on the air regularly. Now it's your time. We're going to get you on the air soon. So my folks will be calling in. And think about the best practices in the division that you want to celebrate and let the entire region know about the great work happening here in the division. We've also done something that, again, the tool that may be useful here in the division. A few years back, superintendents and teachers were saying, why can't we just put a smart teacher, a great teacher, in front of a camera and teach classes topic by topic and put it online? So if we got a snow day, if we have a teacher that maybe isn't well versed in the subject matter, the parent doesn't understand the topic, that they can go and watch a master teacher teach a class. So we've done that now with algebra and with geometry. They're a little different than our regular courses because those are rich media. These are simply a master teacher using some whiteboard technology. Every single topic is available online through eMedia VA. So if a parent wants to work with their students on algebra, but frankly they don't remember algebra, many of us don't, they can watch the teacher themselves and then they can work with their students. If a student just wants to have it presented in a different way from a different teacher, these are available right now. It's free to you, eMedia VA, algebra and geometry. And we're looking at maybe earth science for next year. We'll see about that. But that's been the conversation we've had with superintendents. And I won't go into a lot of detail on pages 7, 8, and 9. Those are our family and early learner services. On page 9, we summarize those. But these are our reading camps and our library corners and coding camps. And these are for your earliest learners, and we do a lot here in the division, and we'd love to do even more. Again, it doesn't cost you any more as owners of the station. Finally, page 10, the ROI. You can see the investment you make in WHRO, which is $2 per student. Last year, you had savings in value of $1.3 million. A pretty good ROI, we think.
Yep.
And we thank you, and happy to take any questions.
Any questions for Mr. Nance?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Schmidt and I met quite by accident about a common interest called K-12 Inc. And I want him to explain the difference between virtual Virginia and Virginia virtual.
Thank you for that. There's a big difference other than the words are the same, it's a reverse. Virtual Virginia is the state's program. They have to go through you. So as I mentioned, if a student, whether it's a student in the building right here or it's a homeschooler, they take a virtual Virginia course, you're gonna get ADM for that. The other scenario, and there's legislation that was passed last year by the governor vetoed, HB 8, and it's back as HB 1400, it's Virginia Virtual. This is a program pushed by K-12 Inc., as you mentioned. Students would work with a commercial vendor, and if your students, even if they're in this building, if they're your students to take a full-time program through Virginia Virtual, your ADM does not come here, it goes to the vendor. So you lose ADM depending on who they go with. So we've been pushing hard to save your ADM through Virtual Virginia. Right. There's a bill, it gets very confusing for people. Sometimes they think they're advocating for one when they mean the other. So Virtual Virginia is the program that keeps ADM within the division.
Also, at our last meeting, Mr. Schmidt and Mr. Callahan have learned not to be surprised by anything I say. I saw that the ROI was 36 to 1, 37 to 1, and I asking for when are we going to sit down and talk about maximizing that? And I think we're going to meet pretty soon.
We would love to. It sounds like there are some issues we might be able to help address a little bit, especially in the virtual space. Early learner services.
But with us being one of the 19 owners of WRHRO, we're in a unique position that we own something really valuable that's not just a UHF channel anymore.
That's true.
There's going to be another channel come on soon. Is that what you said?
Well, it's a 24/7 kids channel that will be available to be streamed through phones or tablets. It'll have digital content along with the programming. So it's right now our kids' channel is over the air, but you can't stream it. So it's a new service. They'll bring digital content along with all these characters that they've grown up with, Elmo and Big Bird and all those great characters.
And we're going to sit down. We're going to discuss how to maximize this and get as much out of it as we can.
We're
going to come back with some exciting plans.
You know how to reach me.
Thank you.
Right.
Thank you very much for coming. Good to see both of you, Mr. Callahan. Goes back a few years. Next item on the agenda is presentation of the SBA Academy Awards to school board members. Dr. Bracey.
Thank you, Chairman Parent. Each year, the VSBA, Virginia School Boards Association, awards school board members for their dedication and their work for professional development. And with that, the level of participation, there are different levels that you receive for your time that you spent receiving that professional development. So those of you that will be receiving recognition tonight and the level of it, Reverend Cardell Patillo, Award of Recognition. Sarah D. Hines, Award of Excellence, Silver Pen. Mr. Claude C. Parent, Award of Excellence, Silver Pen. Costello B. Williams, Award of Recognition. Myself, Award of Recognition. Keith Nance, Award of Honor, Gold Pen. James Bridgefoot, Award of Recognition. Ted Lamb, Award of Recognition. Joseph Fleming, Award of Recognition, and Kathy Chambliss, Award of Recognition. And I have the pins and certificates here that I will pass.
Thank you, Dr. Bracy. The next item on the agenda is presentation of the school attendance report for September 2016. Dr. Bracy.
Thank you, sir. At this time, we'll have our first report of the year from Mr. Wiggins as we look at our attendance report for the month of September. Mr. Wiggins, if you will come forward at this time and share this information.
Thank you. I would simply remind the board that we are always a month behind. The figures that we're about to present were compiled for the month of September. The average monthly percentage of student attendance for our preschools for 2015 was 96.09%, and for the current year, 95.89%. And there was a slight decrease of 0.21 of a percentage point. Taking first place honors is Emily Spong Preschool with 96.61%. And coming in second place is Olive Branch Preschool with 96.13%. And the difference between the first place and second place winners is 0.48 of a percentage point. Is the principal here? Okay. Principals in Portsmouth are extremely busy. They have various activities that they are involved in. We next move to the elementary schools. When we look at last September, it was 96.99%, and for the current year, 97.12%, and the difference is it went up 0.13 of a percentage point. Coming in first place is Churchland Primary and Intermediate with 98.62%, and taking second place honors is Victory Elementary with 97.78%. The principal of Churchland Primary and Intermediate was on leave today because she funeralized her grandmother, so there's no one here to take it for Churchland Primary. We will see to it that the school gets it. We move next to our middle schools. For 2015, it was 95.39%. For the current year, 94.90%. And the difference is a slight decrease of 0.49 of a percentage point. Taking first place honors is Churchland Middle School with 96.13%, and coming in second place, William Waters Middle School with 94.68%. The difference there is 1.44 of percentage points. The principal of Churchland Middle, next to our high schools, for 2015, it was 94.39%, and for the current year, 94.23%. Slight decrease of 0.16 of a percentage point. In first place honors since the award was instituted is Churchland High School with 97.20%. And coming in second place is Woodrow Wilson High School with 94.43%. And the difference there is 2.77 percentage points. Mr. Malachi. Churchton's principal couldn't understand why he had to remove the banner.
Oh.
We next look at the school division. In 2015, it was 96.29%, and for the current year, it's 96.24%. And from last year to the current year, it's 0.05 of a percentage point, a drop. We next show a summary for the preschools, the elementary schools, the middle schools, the high schools, and for the school division. And again, we want to extend our sincere and heartfelt appreciation to everyone involved in the all-important task of getting our boys and girls to school. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wiggins. The next item on the agenda is a resolution, American Education Week, November 14th through the 18th, 2016. Dr. Bracey.
And Mr. Wiggins, will you read this resolution, please?
Resolution, whereas as advocates for children, we endeavor to provide appropriate opportunities for them to acquire the essential skills, tools, and knowledge required for their success in life and for their future well-being. And whereas education has always been and continues to be an integral part of our instilling in our young people an appreciation for America's defining values, freedom, equality, and respect for one another. And whereas the Portsmouth City School Board is desirous of maintaining America's role as the world's engine of discovery and innovation, and this panel is deeply committed to ensuring that our public school graduates possess marketable skills. And whereas the professional staff has an inherent obligation to provide a complete and competitive education for all students. And whereas by Presidential Proclamation 5403, our nation will pause once again for the annual observance of American Education Week, November 14th through 18th, 2016, focusing on the theme, Great Public Schools, a Basic Right and Our Responsibility. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Portsmouth City School Board reaffirm its commitment to the prime import of education and recognize that everyone shares in the responsibility for providing a high-quality education for our greatest national resource, our children. And be it further resolved that the citizens of this great historic municipality be called upon to continue their support of public education through appropriate activities, events, and programs designed to help create opportunities for every school and student. And be it finally resolved that this resolution be made a part of the school board's official records and that copies be displayed in all administrative offices, schools, and public libraries throughout the city.
Board members, you've heard the resolution. What is your pleasure?
Move for approval.
Second.
Motion's been made and second. Any discussion? Hearing no discussion, Madam Clerk, roll call vote.
Mr. Bridgeport?
Yes.
Reverend Fleming?
Yes.
Mrs. Hines?
Yes.
Mr. Nance?
Yes.
Reverend Petillo?
Yes.
Dr. Whitaker?
Yes.
Mrs. Williams?
Yes.
Mr. Parent?
Yes.
It's unanimous.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is minutes for September the 8th, 2016, and September 22nd. 2016. Board members, what is your pleasure?
Move approval.
Motion's been made and second for approval of the September the 8th and the September 22nd minutes. Any discussion? Hearing no discussion. Board, Madam Clerk, roll call vote, please.
Mr. Bridgeport?
Yes.
Reverend Fleming?
Yes.
Mrs. Hines?
Yes.
Mr. Nance?
Yes.
Reverend Petillo?
Yes.
Dr. Whitaker?
Yes.
Mrs. Williams?
Yes.
Mr. Parent?
Yes.
It's unanimous.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is curriculum and instruction. Dr. Anita Taylor.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Chairman Parent, Vice Chairman Williams, members of the board, and Dr. Bracey, I'm pleased to present the Office of Curriculum and Instruction updates for the month of October. Portsmouth Fire Rescue and Emergency Services visited several of our elementary schools to celebrate Fire Safety Week, and they were able to read stories with the children. The title of the book that they read was No Dragons for Tea. This is an annual event, and it supports literacy in Portsmouth Public Schools by inviting our firefighters to read a book selected by the department to promote fire safety, as well as model good reading habits for our students. And this year, all of our kindergarten and first grade students participated. Coming up on October 27th, many of you will be participating in our annual Read for the Record Day. During this event, our community partners, to include you as board members, will participate by reading the book, The Bear Ate Your Sandwich, to students in our elementary schools. We look forward to that event. Secondary math specialists India Hatcher, Tisha Jones, and Kendra Frazier are presenting two sessions at the 20th Annual Women Marry Math Day, and that was actually held on October 18th this week. Several elementary math specialists attended the Virginia Council of Math Specialists Fall Conference on September 29th and 30th this year. We had 50 science teachers, grades 5 through high school, who will be receiving training on our Jason Learning Project on November 1st and 2nd. And this is an online curriculum that works with world-class partners to bring real-life science into our classrooms. We're very excited about it. Examples include National Geographic, NASA, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, NOAA, Ocean Exploration Trust, and the Smithsonian. The local mayor and presidential mock election will be held for grades 3 through 12 on October 27th, and we're excited about that. Our Hampton Roads Naval Museum outreach program will begin for grades 3 and 6, respectively, in November and January, and the presentation information and teacher schedules are due to the Office of Social Studies on October 28th, so we should have that for you soon. The VPI grant, the Virginia Preschool Initiative grant, was revised, and we've asked for additional funds, and they are now available, and they will be allocated for preschool supplies, for field trips, staff development, and parent and family engagement. Parent and family engagement, by the way, is a new component for our pre-K centers this year. We have two Saturday workshops with Ron Nash for our staff in Title I schools, and those are being held one this Saturday and one on November the 5th. We have about 260 teachers who've signed up for those, and they each will get a copy of his book, From Seat Work to Feet Work. And Ron Nash, by the way, was our keynote speaker for the Leadership Institute this year. Title I Part A and DF grant applications have been approved by VDOE, yes. And we are anxiously awaiting the approval of our Title II application. PE teachers Christine Thompson of IC Norcom and Diane Dennis of Churchland attended the Virginia Driver Education and Traffic Safety Conference on October 7th and 8th in Newport News. And our teachers attended workshops regarding the 2016 legislation, car safety, interactive driver education, and they visited a driving range. They experience new and innovative strategies for the classroom that can help prepare our students to be safe and responsible drivers. On October 12th, we had our annual Safety Town, Safety in the Streets Day at Portsmouth Safety Town. Many of you attended that event, and members of the Portsmouth family were definitely present, as our own Dr. Bracey was the keynote speaker for the day, and it was quite an exciting event for us. I want to also remind you that Virginia Disability History and Awareness Month, and the purpose of this is to increase our public awareness and respect for individuals with disabilities, inform the public of their many contributions to society, and encourage community awareness of the needs of persons with disabilities and emphasize their abilities and rights as individuals. And so we want to make sure that we recognize that. Our final announcement is that we have received $25,000 in a grant from the Virginia Tiered System Support Group, and this will help us continue our training for PBIS, and it will also be an opportunity for us to continue that implementation, hopefully for the next 2 to 3 years with more funding from them. Thank you, and that concludes our report.
Thank you. Any questions from the board? Ms. Hines?
Thank you, Chairman. I just also wanted to mention Minds in Motion. We were...
Yes.
There, Dr. Bracey, Vice Chair Williams, myself, and Dr. Taylor, we got on stage and danced last night at Norcom High School with Minds in Motion. And so I would like to that program expanded. That was one of the things we talked about last night, but that was a wonderful program. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I can't wait for me to go home and try to get my son to dance and bring all that in. But it was wonderful. So, Dr. Bracey, thank you for bringing it here. And I can't wait to see it expand.
I might add that Ms. Newsom, my PIO, tweeted Dr. Bracey dancing, and it has received, I think, the most tweets of any of our tweets yet. The most views of any of our tweets yet.
Very good.
And I would also like to thank, when I got up last night, I failed to thank Ms. Gwen Jenkins.
Oh, yeah.
Because she was definitely the person that was the facilitator between the Richmond Ballet and Portsmouth Public Schools. So she did put everything together, and it was seamless from the reception to the performance. So from the transportation of the students, I mean, you name it, she was on top of it. It was first class. So I didn't get a chance to thank her, but I want to thank her now because I know this will be airing. She's not here tonight, but we appreciate her efforts as well.
Absolutely, and I want to also say that Ms. Jenkins prepared the food herself. She knew that we were working on a tight budget, and she came to me and she said, Dr. Taylor, I will make it happen, and that she did, and it was a wonderful event from start to finish, so she has been phenomenal in that success.
Thank you. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is the Human Resources and Operations Report. Mr. Scott Ziegler.
Good evening, Chairman Parent, Vice Chairman Williams, members of the board. If you'll allow me just a little bit of wiggle room tonight, Chairman Parent, I've invited some guests here to help me make my report, and those are members of our operation and facilities staff. If they would come join me at the podium, please. Good. They're all going to be angry at me tomorrow. Mm. They're going to say, I didn't know you were going to call us up. As you all know, the weather has not been kind to us over the past 8 weeks or so. Tropical storm Hermine hit us right before the opening of school. In late September, we had a major rain event that dumped upwards of 17 inches of rain in the area, causing widespread flooding and canceling 2 days of classes in Portsmouth. And finally, Hurricane Matthew came out for a most unwelcomed October visit, causing a significant amount of flooding and damage throughout Portsmouth and Hampton Roads. The reason I'm providing this weather recap is that it gives me the opportunity to publicly and formally acknowledge and commend the hard work and dedication of the men and women who make up the PPS Operations Department. These custodians, tradesmen and tradeswomen, delivery drivers, bus monitors, warehouse workers, food service workers, supervisors, and coordinators have worked tirelessly and without complaint through each weather event to ensure that our schools were safe, clean, and ready to open. There's a complete list of some of the work they've done over the past month, but allow me to highlight just a few examples of how they have gone above and beyond the call of duty. During Hurricane Matthew, a tree fell, blocking the entrance to the building at Clark. That's where we keep all our cleanup equipment. Two of our workers went out in the rain and chainsawed enough of the tree away so that others could access the equipment and keep our buildings clean and safe. A team comprised of all of our operations staff, after they had worked hard to clean their own buildings, left their own buildings and went over to West Haven Elementary School, which, if you didn't see the pictures, Clifford Street was under about 4 to 6 feet of water, which included the newest wing at West Haven. They worked tirelessly into the night, and we had that school clean, sanitized, and ready to open without missing a minute of class time on Tuesday morning. And most importantly to the community, with less than 3 hours notice, operations, transportation, and food services staff were able to prepare IC Norcom High School as a shelter and welcome Portsmouth residents flooded out from their homes. The operations team extraordinary commitment to the students of Portsmouth Public Schools is to be commended and celebrated. They have demonstrated their desire to go the extra mile and provide the very best for our young people. And so I wanted to publicly thank them tonight.
Mr. Ziegler, I want to thank them as well. I think I recognize all of them except for maybe one. Good to see you again. For those of you who don't know, that was the gentleman that at convocation that wanted to know who I was. So there he is, up close and personal.
Much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman Pearmitt. Now we just have, for the board's consideration, the transaction report for the month of October.
Move for approval.
Second.
Motion's been made and second. Any discussion? Hearing no discussion. Madam Clerk, roll call vote, please.
Mr. Bridgeport?
Yes.
Reverend Fleming?
Yes.
Mrs. Hines?
Yes.
Mr. Nance?
Yes.
Reverend Patillo?
Yes.
Dr. Whitaker?
Yes.
Mrs. Williams? Mr. Parent?
Yes.
It's unanimous.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is a roll call vote. It is a resolution, one-time discretionary bonus to school board employees. Dr. Bracey?
Thank you, Chairman Parent. Ms. Deutsch will share some information on that, please.
Good evening, Chairman Parent, Vice Chair Williams, members of the school board, Dr. Bracey. It's my pleasure to provide a resolution to award a one-time discretionary bonus to school board employees for fiscal year 2017. Whereas the Portsmouth City School Board appreciates each employee's contributions toward the achievement of the school division's success in educating students, and whereas on May 26, 2016, the school board approved a one-time discretionary bonus for fiscal year 2017, now therefore be it resolved that the Portsmouth City School Board award bonuses of $818.19 before taxes to all active full-time employees, all active part-time bus drivers, and all part-time food services employees covered under the school board's pay and classification plan. And be it further resolved that all eligible employees who will receive the bonus shall be those actively employed as of September 30th, 2016, and who are still employed by the school board as of November 23rd, 2016. And be it further resolved that the bonus payment shall be issued as a separate check on December 9th, 2016, and will be subject to all applicable federal and state flat taxes and legal wage attachments in accordance with Section 8.01-511 of the Virginia Code. And be it finally resolved that this resolution be made part of the school board's official minutes and copies be displayed in all administrative offices and schools throughout the division.
Board members, you've heard the resolution. What is your pleasure?
Move for approval.
Motion has been made and second. Any discussion? The only discussion I have, and being on the finance team, I wish that this would be could have been a 2% salary increase for our employees. However, having a bonus and this bonus coming right before the holidays, I think it's going to be a plus. And I just say to all the employees, this board is committed to making sure that doing our best to provide financial resources, and we're going to strive in 2017 to look for raises for our employees. But a bonus is a bonus. I realize it's not part of your VRS. It doesn't help you that way, but it's coming in a very timely manner and right before the holidays, and we wish everyone that this could be more, but this is the best that this board could do that during this time. Are there any other discussion from board members? Hearing no more discussion, Madam Clerk, roll call vote, please.
Mr. Bridgeport?
Yes.
Reverend Fleming?
Yes.
Mrs. Hines?
Yes.
Mr. Nance?
Yes.
Reverend Patillo? Dr. Whitaker?
Yes.
Mrs. Williams?
Yes.
Mr. Parent?
Yes.
It's unanimous.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda is the financial report. Ms. Storch?
Provided in board docs is the monthly financial report for September 2016. Within the executive summary is an overview of each of one of our funds with the revenue and expenditures to date. I just wanted to highlight for the general fund that our spending is lagging behind last year, but that is due to the amount of encumbrances that actually got reappropriated into fiscal year 16. So that's the main difference with how we're spending. But also to note that because this is the first quarter of our fiscal year and majority of our employees don't come back to work to September, that's another reason why spending is always low at this time.
Okay. This is roll call vote. What is the board's pleasure?
Move approval.
Motion's been made and second. Any discussion? Hearing no discussion, Madam Clerk, please roll call vote.
Mr. Bridgeford?
Yes.
Reverend Fleming?
Yes.
Mrs. Hines?
Yes.
Mr. Nance?
Yes.
Reverend Patillo?
Yes.
Dr. Whitaker?
Yes.
Mrs. Williams?
Yes.
Mr. Parent?
Yes.
It's unanimous.
Thank you. Moving right along to the superintendent's report, Dr. Bracey.
Thank you, Chairman Parent. First, we'd like to say that the United Way kickoff took place on October 6th. This year's theme is Good Things Happen When You Give, and our campaign will run for 4 weeks, beginning October 10th. So we look forward to raising funds to support the community. And as you all remember, we had our report from last year given at the last board meeting. So we're looking forward to giving again this year. Our budget surveys will be released to the school division, general staff, and public tomorrow, October 21st. So we look forward to the feedback regarding those surveys. We have schools that are going to be closed on Tuesday, November 8th, for the general election. And we will be observing Veterans Day on Friday, November 11th, and Thanksgiving, November 24th and 25th. Mr. Parent and Mrs. Williams and the rest of the board, Dr. Patton asked that I share this award with you. It's the 2016, and it's goal level, Stairway to Success, supporting early childhood education for the city of Portsmouth.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So it was an award that they applied for through the state, and we were selected, the city of Portsmouth was selected at the goal level. What it required was they had questions that involved some curriculum items that we were providing, and along with Dr. Taylor and our CNI department, they completed those questions and gave it to them to complete their packet. And from there, she brought down the nice little trophy and asked that I share it with you. So there you go, and congratulations to the city and our part in helping.
Nice, thank you.
Also would like to share that we received the $250,000 grant, and that is dealing with our adult ed for the fiscal year of 2017. So this will help us with our GED initiative outreach to adults who lack secondary credentials. So this will be funds that we will definitely utilize. And these funds, they came from lottery proceeds. Okay, Ms. Hines talked about the Minds in Motion, so I don't have to mention that. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Bracey. The next item on the agenda is the roll call vote. Inclement weather makeup days, Wednesday, October 26, 2016, and Monday, January 30th, 2017. What is the board's pleasure?
Second.
Motion's been made and second. Any discussion? Hearing no discussion, Madam Clerk, roll call vote, please.
Mr. Bridgeford?
Yes.
Reverend Fleming?
Yes.
Mrs. Hines?
No.
Mr. Nance?
yes.
Reverend Patillo.
Yes.
Dr. Whitaker.
Yes.
Mrs. Williams.
Yes.
Mr. Parent.
Yes.
7 yes votes, 1 no, it passes.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is board members' comments and concerns. Looking down the... All right, and the last item on the agenda... Oh, is... do I have a motion to adjourn? Motion's been made and second that we adjourn. All in favor? You may get up and leave because we're about to freeze to death. Mr. Malachi, thank you very much, you and your staff, for hosting us. We appreciate it. Thank you. Good night, and thank you for coming.